university originated in four women's teacher training colleges. We had actually a good idea. In the
Please be seated. I can't see some students among this lot.
There are some, but it's...
Yes, there are some.
Your Holiness, distinguished guests and colleagues, it's my really pleasant duty as the Vice-Chancellor to welcome you all. And I'd like to extend a particular welcome to His Holiness the Khalifa and to the President of the Muslim Association in the UK, Rafiq Ahmed Hayat, and to the MP for Putney, Justine Greening. And I'm very grateful to you all for coming. A number of us have enjoyed Ahmadi hospitality at the annual Peace Symposium and the annual lecturers at the Bat al-Futu Mosque in Morden, and therefore we're very pleased indeed to reciprocate by welcoming you to the university today. I think Roehampton is very fortunate as a university in many ways. We have a rich and interesting history that stretches back over 150 years. We've got, without doubt, the most beautiful campus of any university in London, and if you've had a chance to walk around the lakes today, you'll see what I mean. And we're also very fortunate in being part of a very vibrant local community. And that community is very important to us. It's important to us that we serve it to the best of our abilities. And we do that in a number of ways. The most obvious way, of course, is by providing good quality and extensive educational opportunities for local people. And I'm pleased to say that Roehampton is the university of choice for those local people who do choose to go into higher education. And we've also got partnerships with literally hundreds of schools, businesses, and voluntary groups in southwest London, and we work with them to the benefit of the community. And I'm particularly proud of the fact that each year over 300 of our students take part in organised voluntary activities with over 70 charitable organisations, again, to help support local people. One of the characteristics of Roehampton, and something we're very proud of, is the diversity in our community. Our students literally come from all walks of life, and in fact, we have over 100 nationalities on campus. Our students and our staff come from many different social, cultural, and faith traditions, and I'm pleased to say, including a number of students and indeed staff who come from the Ahmadi community. Having such a diverse student body is very important to us. University education isn't just about what students learn from their teachers, it's about what they learn from each other. And it's about them engaging with and learning to understand and value different traditions, different perspectives, different ways of looking at things. And that's why I believe very strongly that a modern university must have a wide and diverse social mix of students if it's to provide the sort of education that prepares our graduates to have the skills that they need if they're going to rise to the challenges that they're going to face in a world that is changing very fast indeed. I'm delighted that the Khalifa has accepted my invitation to visit us and to talk to us, and I'm very much, having heard him speak before, very much looking forward to what he has to say to us this afternoon. Dr. Peter Briggs, the Pro Vice Chancellor, will introduce our guest in just a moment, but first we will listen to a reading from the Holy Quran, first of all in Arabic and then in an English translation.
Some MPA also.
She's supposed to be here. I don't see her.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم من كان يريد ثواب الدنيا فعند الله ثواب من كان يريد ثواب الدنيا فعند الله ثواب الدنيا والآخرة وكان الله سميعا بصيرا يا أيها الذين آمنوا كونوا قوامين بالقسط شهداء لله كونوا قوامين بالقسط شهداء لله ولو على أنفسكم أو الوالدين والأقربين إن يكن غنيا أو فقيرا فالله أولى بهما فلا تتبعوا الهوى أن تعدلوا وإن تلووا أو تعرضوا فإن الله كان بما تعملون خبيرا
As-salamu alaykum. I give you the English translation of the verses that have just now been recited. Verse number 135, 136 from chapter 4 of the Holy Quran. I seek refuge with Allah from Satan the accursed. In the name of Allah, the gracious, the merciful. Whoso desires the reward of this world, then let him remember that with Allah is the reward of this world and of the next. And Allah is all hearing, all seeing. O ye who believe, be strict in observing justice and be witnesses for Allah, even though it be against yourself or against your parents or kindred, whether he against whom witness is borne be rich or poor, Allah is more regardful of them both. Therefore, follow not your low desires, that you may act equitably, and if you hide the truth and evade it, then know that Allah is well aware
of what you do. Thank you.
I'd like to add my welcome to that of the Vice-Chancellors. We're delighted to see you all here this afternoon. And may I say to His Holiness that we are particularly delighted to welcome you within Roehampton to Southlands College, which is a Christian foundation in the Methodist tradition. We strongly believe that it's important for people of faith, and indeed of no faith for that matter, to explore together how fundamental values that we share, such as peace and love, can be made manifest in today's world. The Ahmadiyya movement was established in 1889 by Hadhrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmed in a small and remote village in the Punjab. Today, it has over 200 million adherents in many parts of the world. Since the founder's death in 1908, the movement has been led by a series of khalifas. His Holiness Hadhrat Mirza Masroor Ahmed, our guest today, was elected as the fifth Khalifa in 2003. He is indeed the great-grandson of the founder of the Ahmadiyya movement. Born and brought up in Pakistan, his education in that country culminated with the award of a master's degree in agricultural economics in 1976. The following year, he went to work for the Ahmadiyya movement in Ghana under the Nusrat Jahan scheme, which supports a large number of hospitals and schools in West Africa. He was the founding principal of the Ahmadiyya Secondary School in Sagal. After 2 years there, he became principal of a similar school in Essaquia. And then 4 years later, manager of the Ahmadiyya Agricultural Farm in Dipali, in North Ghana. In this latter post, he and colleagues played a key role in helping to revolutionize Ghana's economy by paving the way for self-sufficiency when they successfully developed, for the first time in that country, a method of planting, growing, and nurturing wheat as an economic crop. He returned to Pakistan in 1985, after which he took on a variety of roles of increasing responsibility within the Ahmadiyya movement, in its financial affairs, as its director of education, and finally, as what we would refer to as its chief executive officer. Some 18 years after his return from Ghana, he was elected as the fifth Khalifa on the 22nd of April, 2003. Love for all, hatred for none, is one of the major themes of the Ahmadiyya community. His Holiness has chosen as the theme for his address today, Islam, a religion of peace. And we look forward greatly to what he has to say to us. Please welcome him.
أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم The Pro Vice Chancellor, Roehampton University, Dr. Peter Briggs, the Vice Chancellor, Southland College Professor M. Paul Opere, all the distinguished guests, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Peace and blessing of Allah be on you all. I have been given 40 to 45 minutes to speak on this topic, so I will try to finish the subject in brief. The key issue of the world today is peace. the erosion of peace on the tip of everyone's tongue. Some attribute this to economic causes, others to social issues, whether on an individual, national, or international level. Yet others point to political causes, whilst others attribute it to religious differences, and as a consequence, to the very concept of God. Time does not permit me to go into its various subdivisions and other causes, but if we examine this fairly, the primary cause is man's extreme selfishness and his neglect of the purpose of his creation. Be that as it may, I shall say a few words on the basis of the teachings of Islam and the Holy Quran. In turn, this perspective of true Islam is based on the direct guidance received from God Almighty by the holy founder of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, which he conveyed to us and by means of which we have been shown the ways of establishing peace in the world. This is important because some people who call themselves Muslims do not have a proper understanding of Islam and are responsible for presenting such an image of Islam that it is not even remotely connected to true and fundamental teachings and the example set by the founder of Islam. The Holy Prophet, peace and blessing of Allah be upon him, in pursuit of their personal and selfish vested interests, some so-called Muslim scholars or leaders have created this backward concept to grow amongst a group of ill-informed Muslims. Such people neither serve Islam nor mankind. As I have just said, that all the causes that disturb peace, be they major or minor, and whether they are manifest or hidden and working underground, are attributable to man's growing selfishness and his forgetfulness of why he is here in this world. If one forgets the purpose of one's creation, one becomes selfish. In turn, this selfishness and conceit at different levels leads to usurping the rights of others. In other words, this is a satanic cycle, and man is finding it increasingly difficult to find a way out, despite the fact that there is a desire to come out of it. There is no easy means out. Now we see what is the Islamic teaching about the purpose of man's creation and how man can achieve this. God Almighty says in the Holy Quran, "And I have not created the jinn and the men, but that they may worship me." Chapter 51, verse 57. Therefore, it is the basic reality that if man recognizes God, peace will be established in the world. It should always be remembered that the lack of peace, whether at domestic or international levels, is caused by the unrest of the heart, and the unrest of the heart can be removed by the purpose taught to us in the Holy Quran. This commandment, or call it a teaching or formula, is for all kinds of people. Great, powerful people who hold personal power have been addressed just as different superpowers, and the very wealthy people, as is obvious from the Arabic word jinn. And the word ins or men means the ordinary people of a country and poor people and nations who have been asked to reflect upon their purpose of creation. When you understand this issue, your priorities will change. When priorities will alter, Your life will naturally change according to the nature in which man has been created, and whose example we can see in an innocent child. The child is unattached to the world and all that is in it, irrespective of whether it speaks to a dictator or a fakir or a poor man. It says whatever it sees because it knows not the ways of the world. But as it grows older and in its learning age begins to be reprimanded or punished on its deeds, it responds as best befits the situation. But that response is removed from that nature of innocence and truth. As a result, it gradually drifts away from the purpose for which man was created. I should perhaps explain here as to what is meant by worship. According to an Ahmadi Muslim, worship is to discharge the rights owed to the Creator, to bow before the Lord, and to discharge all the rights of His creation, which include all kinds of personal, social, economic, and moral rights. To return to the subject, although a majority of this world acknowledges that there is a creator of all that exists in the universe, it is in doubt about faith or considers some faith, or if I can be more specific, considers Islam neither to be a true religion nor from God. One reason is the unawareness of the true teaching of Islam. Secondly, the evil deeds committed by some people make them even more dubious. As I said earlier, there is unfortunately a group amongst Muslims which commits foul deeds in the name of Islam, but this group is not even remotely connected to Islam because of their deeds. Those who do not believe in religion and deny the existence of God make religion the primary target for the lack of peace and go so far as to attribute this to the concept of God, even though there are many other reasons for this disorder in the world, as stated earlier. Then, as an Ahmadi Muslim, I believe that God sent His messengers to their respective people with moral and spiritual guidance so as to teach man tolerance, respect, and how to live at peace with other people. The messengers fulfilled their assigned missions. Finally, God sent Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, peace and blessing of Allah be upon him, with the declared message that we have sent you not but as a mercy for all peoples. Chapter 21, verse 108. Therefore, it is inconceivable that the prophet who was sent as a mercy for all the people by the Lord of the heaven and the earth to share his bounties could bring a teaching of cruelty and spreading disorder. Nor is it possible that a God who sent such a prophet could be a God who should cause his creation to suffer cruelty and transgression. The prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a mercy for his friends and foes. It was his kindness and compassion that converted the backward and uncivilized Arabs, who neither had regard for relations nor any social responsibility, into a civilized people with high moral values. In fact, I believe that God Almighty revealed such a teaching that was to foster love and affection and mercy, not only amongst the generations that followed him, but generations that were yet to come till the end of time, providing that they comply with this true spirit and do not confine themselves to the teachings, but adopt it in practice. The history of Islam is full of such noble examples. For instance, the most deprived and worthy of kindness individuals in Arabia were the slaves.
that every rich person of that time possessed. Before the advent of Islam, the slaves were treated in a most cruel way. After a hard day's labor, they were not even fed properly. In order to restore the rights to a deprived class and create a peaceful society, Islam advocated the kind treatment of slaves by saying that if you employ them for hard work, help them. Then in relation to the emancipation of slaves, the Holy Quran teaches, and what should make you know what the Aqaba or ascent is? It is the freeing of a slave. Chapter 90, verse 13, 14. This action of yours against a deprived class whom you have subjugated and whose rights are being violated is disliked by God in respect of his creation. This is why in the do's and don'ts mentioned in the Holy Quran, and in some cases punishments or expiation has been prescribed, one of which is that if you have a slave, he should be set free. As for the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, he himself set free all the slaves he possessed long before his claim of prophethood. These slaves became indebted to him. One of them was Zayd. When his father and his other relatives came to take him back, he refused to go with them even though he was free and said, I cannot leave the person who loves me so much and is so careful about discharging the rights of the poor people. The Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, advised the Muslims that if you wish to enter paradise, free the slaves. There are two benefits of this teaching. One is a means of entering paradise in the hereafter. The other is that by granting freedom in this world to a deprived class, you will be able to grant them the same status of a free man. This will remove the unrest within, because it is quite possible that if this unrest continues to grow in them, then a time will come when the slaves will fight for their freedom and societal peace will disappear. If a society is peaceful, it can be an example of paradise on earth, but the lack of peace can become a hell. Just look at today's society. When superpowers compel other nations to agree to their terms and conditions and effectively hold them in bondage, a time comes when there is a reaction against this bondage. Past history bears testimony to this, and the same is happening today. A society in which there is peace will look beautiful, but where there is fire and bloodshed, the same society will seem like hell. Today, the ways of enslaving and bondage have changed, but the underlying concepts of exploitation are the same, that conditions are imposed on weak nations and the developing countries in respect of debt provided as aid for their development projects so that they are permanently held under the yoke of slavery. We are witnessing the consequence of this unwise logic being suffered by the whole world. Therefore, the developed countries should help the developing world to gain economic independence. They should assist them so that they are able to utilize their own resources to enable them to stand on their own feet and thus strengthen their economy. When each country looks at another country and each nation looks at another nation as equals, the thought will never come to mind that we have to monopolize the market. They will never think that they have to only help the poor nations so that they do not perish of when they are about to die. Announce some economic aid and inject a temporary boost of assistance and publicize that, look here, how much aid has been given to the poor nations. Till this way of thinking changes, unrest and lack of peace will continue to be the hallmark of the world. It is true that these are the mistakes committed by the people and leaders of underdeveloped countries and their weaknesses, apathy, worthlessness, and selfishness are playing a key role. However, if there is a desire for true peace, then wealthier nations can relate their aid to the GDP and pace of economic growth of the developing countries. This is the only way to emancipate the world from economic slavery and to solve the problem of restlessness and that arises from economic causes. I should mention here the teachings of Islam regarding how to end economic unrest and how to create an economically peaceful society. Quran says, those who devour interest do not rise except as rises one whom Satan has smitten with insanity. That is because they say trade also is like interest, whereas Allah has made trade lawful and made interest unlawful. So to whom an admonition comes from his Lord and he desists, then will that which he received in the past be his, and his affair is with Allah. And those who revert to it, they are all the inmates of the fire, therein shall they abide. Allah will abolish interest and will cause charity to increase, and Allah loves not anyone who is a confirmed disbeliever and an arch sinner. Chapter 2, verses 276 to 277. Then it further says, but if you do it not, then beware of war from Allah and His Messenger. And if you repent, then you shall have your original sums. Thus you shall not wrong, nor shall you be wronged. And if any debtor be in straitened circumstances, then grant him respite till a time of ease, and that you remit at it as charity shall be better for you if only you knew. Chapter 2, verse 282-81. I have cast this Islamic teaching here as following the reference to economic bondage. If we assess the world today, it is only interest that has enslaved the people and nations. Keep aside the man of a poor nation. Even a common man in the developed world is enslaved to interest. Although apparently the person is the possessor of property, yet he rarely becomes the true owner of the property up to the time of his death. His earning power, the increase in the rate of inflation, and the repayment of interest do not enable the poor man to leave the world free of debt. The same is the situation with the poor countries. They are immersed in debt. And this economic slavery perpetuates through generations. I cannot go into further details on this issue, but if you look into it yourself, you will no doubt agree with me. Therefore, as I have quoted from the teachings of the Holy Quran, Islam instructs that you should not enslave people through interest, because when you are cruel to a needy person, your greed for interest will make your thinking evil and cruel. You will not be counting the true and base capital, but will give greater preference to interest, and as a result, you will continue to squeeze further an already crushed class. So, if you are a true Muslim, then lend sympathetically and without interest, because God Almighty will bless your capital. This act will also foster love and affection for others, and a peace-loving society will begin to emerge. Otherwise, remember this well, that by disobeying God, you are declaring war against God. Due to interest, the ability to repay will diminish, unrest will increase, and a time will come when you will fight against each other. So it is better for you that you stick to your basic capital. And with reference to the capital, the teaching is that grant him respite till a time of ease. and that if you remit it as charity, it shall be better for you. I should clarify here that Islam requires the borrower to honor his debt and pledge even if he has suffered hardship in order to repay the debt. In other words, this is not a one-way street. Both are bound to discharge their duties. But both the lender and the borrower have been bound that in order to maintain social peace, they have to work hard together. So this is one of the Islamic teaching of God about honoring the economic rights so as to create economic and social peace in the world. What was the example of the Holy Prophet, peace and blessing of Allah be upon him, with regards to the repayment of debt? He always repaid more than he had borrowed. That is to say, by repaying more as a reward for the help that was given at the time of need rather than as predetermined amount agreed at the outset. That is why such an act leads one to love and affection and will guarantee peace. And in this regard, this was his practice with both the Muslims and the non-Muslims. The last words that came from his blessed tongue were to draw attention to two very important issues. He said, O ye Muslims, do not forget my teachings about prayers and slaves. In other words, while you remember your duty to God, that it will lead you to do good works, at the same time, remember the rights of the weakest in the society. Be very kind to your slaves and trying to free them in your task. And never try to enslave those who are free due to their helplessness, whether that enslavement is physical, social, or economic. Then there is another aspect of maintaining peace. Allah Almighty commands, those who fear me and pray to me, they spend in prosperity and adversity. And those who suppress their anger and pardon men, and Allah loves those who do good. Chapter 3, verse 135. Get into the habit of suppressing anger and forgiving others, as this acts as a guarantee for peace in society. It is not easy to suppress anger and forgive people. That is why Allah the Almighty has said that if you wish to develop your association with me, and if you want to gain my pleasure, then you will have to do good to others without expecting anything in return. Doing good means forgiving the guilty despite their wrongdoing. Where in the beginning Allah says to spend, this means spend in the way of Allah for religious needs as well as for fulfilling the rights of the people. If you spend on the needy without their having to ask you, you will guarantee peace. Then we have been commanded to sustain peace because whereas we can suppress our anger and forgive temporarily and can also spend for the good of others and treat them with kindness now and then, it is very difficult to continue to do this good work in a steadfast manner. That is why Allah the Almighty says in the Holy Quran, and those who persevere in seeking the favor of their Lord and observe prayer and spend out of that which we have provided them secretly and openly and repel evil with good, it is these who shall have the best reward of the final abode. Chapter 13, verse 23. It is clear from these verses that one requires not only patience to do good and repel evil, but also steadfastness. And to achieve this, there is also a commandment to not only spend the money, but also share all that knowledge and utilize all the faculties that are required to spread goodness and stop all evil tendencies. Using all the resources that have been put at the discretion of the well-to-do, there is an injunction for both individuals and nations that the establishment of peace requires patience and consistency. It is not enough to stop evil, but it is also essential to do good works. If evil alone is suppressed, there will be a reaction. There are many who incite evildoers to believe that they have been wronged. But if after stopping the evil, all means are used for the improvement of the society, they will realize that the people who advocated doing good works are really their friends and sympathizers who pointed the evil in the society and helped them to remove forward towards goodness. Such action helps to eliminate evil permanently from society. However, this reformation will neither be permanent nor will it help to establish peace if all the action is only to achieve vested personal interests. The Holy Quran teaches us that in order to maintain peace, it is essential to establish justice in society. Beside justice, if good is done in society in accordance with the need, it will help to create an environment of love and affection. I have deliberately used the word in accordance with the need, because you will come across a person who is a habitual criminal, and despite all efforts to reform him, he does not change his ways. It will be counterproductive to do good to him. In fact, in such cases, justice demands that he be punished so that the society can be saved from his harm. Because the real purpose is to create an environment of peace and at the same time protect the rights of everyone. It is this protection that provides peace to the society. The commandment in the Holy Quran is, verily, Allah enjoins justice and doing good to others and giving like kindred and forbids indecency and manifest evil and transgression. He admonishes you that you may take heed. Chapter 16, verse 91. This verse talks about three good and three evil deeds. The three good deeds are showing justice, doing of good to others, and giving like kindred. The three evils mentioned are exhibiting indecency, manifesting evil, and transgressing. Going into the details of these good and evil deeds, you will realize that the good deeds are the basics of establishing peace in a society, and the evils are the basics that lead to the destruction of social peace. Therefore, if we want to create peace in our society, then we must shun all evils, promote good deeds, and fulfill the rights of others selflessly. We must get rid of the poison of superiority complex. We must eliminate the distinction between superpower and the poor developing countries. We must get rid of all the national and racial prejudices. In this regard, we will have to set very high targets. Free of all prejudices, so that humanity can advance in doing good to each other. We may not agree on this, but the divides between East and West and North and South are more prominent. In fact, even today, the question of black and white is still alive and predominant in some countries. Does this situation provide any guarantee for peace of mind? I do not think so. Islam advises its believers, O ye people, fear your Lord who created you from a single soul and of its kind created its mate, and from them twain spread many men and women. And fear Allah in whose name you appeal to one another, and fear Him respecting ties of kinship. Verily Allah watches over you. Chapter 4, verse 2. And again Allah reminds us, O mankind, we created you from male and female, and we made you tribes and sub-tribes. that you may know one another. Verily, the most honorable among you in the sight of Allah is he who is the most righteous among you. Surely, Allah is all-knowing, all-aware. Chapter 49, verse 14. This is the teaching of the Quran. It leads us to the point from where the educated man wants us to move away, and that is that God exists, and by acting on his teachings and just trying to gain his pleasure, it will help man to understand fellow men. What does Islam teach on eliminating prejudices and thoughts of causing harm to others? And to what extent does Islam emphasize on dealing with each other honestly? The Holy Quran says in this respect, O ye who believe, be steadfast in the cause of Allah, bearing witness in equity, and let not a people's enmity incite you to act otherwise than with justice. Be always just, that is nearer to righteousness, and fear Allah. Surely Allah is aware of what you do. Chapter 5, verse 9. This is the ultimate state of establishing peace with justice, that if you have to bear testimony, you must always remain just. In another place, it enjoins that even if you have to testify against yourself or your near ones, then you must testify fulfilling the requirements of justice. At the same time, it has also said that even the enmity of a nation should not make you deviate from justice. We can see this commandment being put into practice in the early period of the Islamic history. For example, when a dispute between a Muslim and a Jew was brought before Hazrat Umar, the second successor of the Holy Prophet of Islam, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he found the Jew to be right and decided in his favor. Then the Holy Quran says, and let not the enmity of a people that they hindered you from the sacred mosque incite you to transgress, and help one another in righteousness and piety, but help not one another in sin and transgression, and fear Allah. Allah is severe in punishment. Chapter 5, verse 3. See, this is the beautiful teaching. The people of Mecca committed extreme cruelties against the Holy Prophet of Islam, peace be upon him, and his followers. They were made to lie on burning coal because they had accepted Islam. Muslim women were pierced with lances in their private parts, and some were tied to two camels, which were then made to run in opposite direction, thus tearing the women asunder in two parts. The Holy Prophet, peace be and blessing of Allah be upon him, was exiled with his followers and ostracized in a valley outside Mecca for 2.5 years, and they suffered from shortage of food and other essentials. After all the sufferings, the Muslims decided to migrate to Medina. Even then, they were attacked. Muslims were stopped from going to Mecca to perform the pilgrimage. Despite all these inhuman acts, Muslims were enjoined not to react in similar fashion. And although they were victims of many cruelties, when they entered victorious into Mecca, they were taught to forget the past. They were taught that you are victorious. Now, therefore, forget old enmities and fear Allah, because Allah wants to spread peace in the world, and he is the creator who should be worshipped. Muslims were told not to indulge in any excesses, but to use piety and goodness to establish peace and to enhance cooperation. If you understand the psychology of the Arabs of that time and how they used to carry enmities from one generation to another, you will realize that it was not possible for the Muslims to act as they did without bringing about revolution in the psyche of the Arabs with the help of the teaching that the Prophet of Islam brought. I have explained briefly various aspects of the peaceful teachings of Islam. The question here arises that this is all very well, but who is going to apply these teachings in the world and among the Muslims? The Ahmadiyya Muslim community is of the view and believes that God Almighty has always sent his messengers and reformers in this world to bring people nearer to God and return to the people that the rights of human beings. In this age also, according to the prophecies of the Prophet of Islam, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and past prophets, peace and blessings of Allah be upon them all, God Almighty has sent Mirza Ghulam Ahmad of Qadian, whom we believe to be the Messiah and the Mahdi, to this world to fulfill his mission. The voice that was raised more than 100 years ago in a small town in the Punjab in India has reached 185 countries of the world. And his followers are in millions now. This could not have happened without the divine assistance. Along with its efforts to bring man nearer his creator, the Ahmadiyya community is serving mankind by fulfilling the medical, educational, and other financial requirements of the needy in poor countries of Africa and elsewhere. The community is helping with hospitals and schools and is trying to provide water and electricity in those regions free of any cost to the poor. Irrespective of race, religion, or nationality, the community has been and is trying to provide assistance to the victims of natural disasters like earthquakes, tsunamis, floods, etc., without any ulterior motives. It is difficult to go into its details. It is worth noting that these expenses that the community incurs are not obtained from businesses, factories, or oil revenues. It is collected from every member of the community who reduces his own expenses to contribute towards these services for gaining sheer love and nearness of Allah. All this is being done to bring humanity nearer to its creator and thus fulfill the mission of the founder of the Ahmadiyya movement. I would like to end my address with a quotation of the founder of the Ahmadiyya community. He says, "The mission for which Allah has appointed me is to renew the relationship between Allah and his creatures and remove the malice that has developed between mankind and its creator, and thus re-establish the relationship of love and sincerity between man and God, to eliminate wars between religion and lay the foundation of reconciliation and bring out the truth and verities that had disappeared from the world and manifest by example the spirituality that had been buried in darkness. But this will not happen by my power alone. It will only come about by the power of the Almighty, who is the Lord of heaven and earth." Finally, I would like to thank all of you who have given your time to listen to me. I'm grateful to the Vice Chancellor for providing me this opportunity, and to the principal of Southland College for organizing everything. May Allah the Almighty enable and reward you all abundantly. Thank you. I was a bit fast to complete.
I'm sure that I speak for all of us in thanking His Holiness for his visit today, not just for the address. He was here for some time. We're very grateful that he took the time to walk round the campus and see from the new-ish in Southlands to the old-ish in Froebel, and find what a beautiful and various campus we have. I've never seen so many cameras in this hall. That's certainly something that you brought with us that we've never had before, so thank you for that. And of course, thank you especially for your words to us just now. In a university which takes pride in the fact that we have a Centre for Human Rights, Social Justice and Citizenship, because that reflects very much of what this university stands for and is founded upon, then the insights which you have shared with us about the teachings of the Holy Quran, of Islam, and the work of the Ahmadiyya community, which have a bearing on all those issues and brought together in the notion of creating a world which is peaceful and which will give peace to those so many millions of people who crave peace but do not find it, are inspirational and insightful, and we're very grateful to them. So thank you very much for your visit and for your words. And thank you to you all for being with us and sharing with us in what has been a memorable and, I'm fairly sure, unique event for this university. Please do all stay for tea afterwards, which will be served in the senior common room. People will show you where to go. But perhaps we can close by once again showing our appreciation to His Holiness for his visit and his address.
Very much about the fact that Islam is a religion of peace, and I think that's a very important message in today's world where there are those who have given Islam a bad name. And this was a very positive account of the role of Islam in promoting peace in the world. I was very struck by His Holiness's opening reference to selfishness as the cause of so much dissension and warlikeness and strife in the world. Although I think I would want to add to that that the economic causes in a world with an ever faster growing population are very important to take into account. The fact that with so many people in the world now, there seems to be competition for vital resources such as water and fuel, which in many parts of the world are increasingly scarce. And I think I can understand why there should be strife where water and fuel and energy are in such short supply. It seems to me absolutely vital that we address that issue and find ways of sharing, which was what His Holiness talked a lot about, the need for us to share our resources in order to make peace with one another.
I was delighted and very, very pleased that he'd come and spoken to us today. You know, many of us get our view of Islam primarily by what we see on television, and His Holiness portrayed a very different view of Islam and what it stood for in terms of peace and justice and love from the impression that we often get by watching our television screens and seeing what's happening in Iraq and other countries. Well, I think one of the things that resonated most strongly, in a sense, just in view of the timing, was what he had to say about what the Quran says about slavery. I think maybe a lot of us didn't know about that, and of course it's very topical. Being in a few weeks since we celebrated the so-called abolition of slavery, and he highlighted the fact that, of course, there are still many modern forms of slavery which need to be tackled. There were many things he said, but that was one of the things that I noted before, which I thought resonated strongly with today's work.
It was me who invited His Holiness to come and speak, because I heard him speak about 2 years ago at the mosque in Morden, which is very close to us. And I was very inspired by then what he had to say about Islam and his role in the world. And that was when I asked him if he would be good enough to come and speak to staff and students here at Roehampton University. And I'm delighted that today he's actually done that and come and spoken to us, because I think the message he portrays in such a modest but inspiring way is, I think, very important for the world to hear today. And I'm very keen that Roehampton as a university is a place where that message that he's got for the world is heard and understood, and we found it, what he's had to say, very interesting, very inspiring, and we would support what he said totally. It was very engaging for us, an important day for us, and we were very pleased that he came to see us.
In your view, what was the highlights of the speech?
I was very interested in what he had to say about slavery, and because that's a big topical subject in the UK at the moment, and a lot of people think that currently we're celebrating the abolition of slavery, which means that in the UK it was made illegal 200 years ago. But of course, we all know that slavery has not been abolished. Slavery still exists in many different forms around the world, and I thought that that was what His Holiness made clear to us, that different forms of slavery can exist, do exist, and that we all have a responsibility to think very hard about what we do to make sure that people who are enslaved, people whose freedom is not something they can take for granted the way that most of us can, we all have a responsibility to those people. And I thought that was that struck me very very strongly. And I was also interested in things he had to say about economic slavery. I thought that was an interesting new idea for me to take on board. I think he's absolutely right about the enslavement and the way that financial debt, for example, and the use of interest can restrict people. And, of course, being head of a university in the UK, I'm aware that lots of students get into debt when they study. It's expensive to study wherever you are in the world. And we do what we can at the university through lots of scholarships and bursaries to free as many of those students from debt as we can. But it's something that we also try to help them understand and cope with in their lives. Because as you're starting out in life with a lot of debt, as His Holiness says, it's going to be a difficulty for you in creating your life. So I think those are things I took. And I think the other thing I took from his speech was the way he spoke about peace and justice, and the way you can't have one without the other. And I think, again, I found that very interesting, and something that, as a university, we would find something that we agree with totally.
Thank you.
Yes, good.
Thank you for taking
Yeah, thanks for having me.